Well, students, in the previous lecture, we studied about this Compton effect phenomena, wherein when incident radiation of wavelength lambda was incident on a scatterer, the scattered radiation was found to have two components, one unmodified component having wavelength lambda and another modified component having wavelength lambda dash, which was greater than lambda. Now, in this lecture, we are going to derive an expression for what is called as the Compton shift. Okay, so first of all, what is Compton shift? Compton shift is defined as the difference in the wavelength of the modified and unmodified component. So Compton shift is lambda dash minus lambda, wavelength of modified component minus the wavelength of unmodified component. This is called as Compton shift. So we're going to derive an expression for this. So this is going to be a slightly lengthy derivation. So but we'll try to finish it in this lecture. But before we proceed with this derivation of Compton shift, I want to show you the formula for the expression of momentum of a photon. Now, we know the formula for momentum of a particle of mass m moving with a velocity v is p is equal to mv. But this formula we cannot use for the momentum of a photon, because photon we know is a particle of light and theoretically the mass of a photon is zero. So if we use this formula, if we put mass as zero, then momentum of a photon will always be zero, which is not the case. So for a photon, we cannot use the formula for momentum as m into v, but we have to use a different expression. So let's see how we obtain this expression for the momentum of a photon. So we start with this general formula for momentum, m into v. Now, for a photon, the velocity of a photon is c, because photon is a particle of light. It moves with the speed of light, c. So m into c. Now what I've done further is I have multiplied and divided by c. Okay, so we get mc square divided by c. Now we know that the famous Einstein's formula mc square is equal to E, energy. So we get this thing as E upon c. Now further, we know that for a photon, energy of a photon is h nu. So we replace E with h nu. So we get momentum as h nu by c. So this is the formula for a momentum of a photon having energy h nu. So momentum of a photon having energy h nu is p is equal to h nu by c. Similarly, momentum of a photon having energy h nu dash will be p dash is equal to h nu dash by c. Okay, so the only thing which changes over there is the frequency, because other things are constant in this formula. H and c are constant. So as the frequency changes, the momentum also changes. So please remember this formula for momentum of a photon. So now coming to the derivation of Compton shift, what we have in this problem here is a incident photon coming from the incident radiation colliding with an electron at rest. Now this electron actually is not at rest. This is an electron from the scatterer. Now we know that in the scatterer there are atoms and electrons are actually going around the nucleus in the atom. So electron is not actually at rest. But remember, the other particle in this problem is a photon. And photon, the speed of a photon is very high, c, the speed of light. So compared to the speed of the photon, the velocity of the electron is negligible. And hence, we said that we assume that the photon electron is initially at rest, so before the collision. So incident photon goes and collides with a electron at rest in the scatterer. And then after the collision, what happens? The photon gets scattered at an angle theta, whereas the electron gets recoiled at an angle phi. So this is just like a problem of billiards, you know, billiards, right? Two balls colliding. So after the collision, one ball goes in another one direction, other ball goes in another direction. So this is a typical collision problem. Okay. So now we are going to assume that the collision between the photon and electron is an elastic collision. Okay. So in an elastic collision, two laws of physics are obeyed. Which are the two laws? One is the law of conservation of energy, which is always obeyed whether the collision is elastic or inelastic. And there's another law called as the law of conservation of momentum, which is obeyed in an elastic collision. So since we are going to assume that this elastic collision between the photon and electron is elastic collision, these two laws will be obeyed, law of conservation of energy and law of conservation of momentum. So this entire derivation is based on these two laws. Now, in this figure, you can see the incident photon initially is in the horizontal direction and it has a momentum h nu by c. Why? Because the incident photon has an energy h nu. So its momentum is h nu by c as per the formula which I had shown you earlier. Electron initially is at rest, so its momentum is zero before collision. Now, after collision, what happens? The photon goes in this direction, gets scattered in this direction, and the energy of the photon after collision is h nu dash. So its momentum after collision is h nu dash by c. The electron, on the other hand, after before collision its momentum was zero, but after collision now the electron is moving, so its momentum is now is m into v, where m is the mass of the electron and v is the velocity with which the electron is moving after the collision. So since now we are going to use the two laws, law of conservation of energy and law of conservation of momentum. Now what is the meaning of this laws? Law of conservation of energy means what? Energy is conserved means what? It basically means that the energy of the system before collision is equal to the energy of the system after collision. Similarly, law of conservation of momentum means energy of the system before collision, momentum of the system before collision is equal to momentum of the system after collision. So this is what the law means, okay, laws means. So therefore, we are going to write formulas for energy and momentum of the photon and electron before and after collision. And then we are going to use these laws, equations to proceed further with the derivation. So now, energy of the photon we know is before collision is h nu, okay. Momentum of the incident photon before collision is what is shown here, it is h nu by c. Energy of the electron before collision, now electron before collision is at rest, it doesn't mean its energy is zero. According to Einstein, any body having a mass m has an energy mc square. So therefore, energy of the electron before collision is m0c square, where m0 is what is called as the rest mass of the electron. Okay, it's the mass of the electron when it is at rest. Now, last thing is the momentum of the electron before collision is zero because the electron initially is at rest. Now, the values after collision, energy of the scattered photon, that is the photon after collision, we know is h nu dash. And its momentum after collision, we know is h nu dash by c as per the formula which we had seen earlier. Energy of the electron, recoil electron, that's the electron after collision, is mc square. Okay, now please note energy before collision was m0c square and energy after collision is mc square, where m is the rest, m is the mass of the electron moving with a velocity v, and this m is different from the mass of the electron when it was at rest. So mass of the electron when it is moving is m, given by the relativistic Einstein's formula. It is m0 divided by root of 1 minus v square by c square. So as per this formula, we see that mass is not a constant, but it depends on the velocity v of the particle. So if the particle is moving with a higher speed as per this formula, the mass of the particle will be higher. If the velocity of the particle is zero, it means the particle is at rest, then its mass will become equal to m0. That's what we have said over here. When the particle electron was at rest initially, its mass was m0. But now, after the collision, the electron is moving with a velocity v and its mass is now m, where m is given by this formula. Okay, so we have to use relativistic formula here because this problem involves velocities close to the speed of light. That is, since we are using a photon here, the photon has a very high speed. Okay, so we have to use relativistic formulas for proceeding in this derivation. Now, momentum of the electron after collision is as per shown in this figure, it is m into v. So now what we are going to use is, we are going to use the law of conservation of energy. Okay, now, so what does the law of conservation of energy says? Energy of the system. Now what do you mean by system in this problem? The system consists of photon and electron together. So law of conservation of energy says energy of system before collision is equal to energy of system after collision. So putting the values of momentum, energy of photon and electron into this equation, we get the law of conservation of equation, law of conservation of energy equation as follows. So energy of photon before collision is h nu, energy of electron before collision is mc square as per these things over here which we have written. Energy of the photon after collision is h nu dash and energy of the electron after collision is mc square. So rearranging this equation, we get the equation in this form. You can work it out and see. So this is equation 2. Next, from the law of conservation of momentum. Now remember, momentum is a vector quantity. Energy is a scalar quantity. So since momentum is a vector, we have to write separate equations for vertical and horizontal directions. There's nothing called as vertical and horizontal direction for energy because energy is scalar. Whereas momentum is a vector, since therefore we have to write momentums in terms of horizontal and vertical components. What is shown over here, this is the momentum vector of the photon h nu dash by c, and this is the horizontal component of the momentum, this is the vertical component of the momentum. Similarly, the electron's momentum is mv, this is the horizontal component, this is the vertical component. So while writing the law of conservation of momentum, we have to write separate equations for vertical horizontal direction and separate equation for vertical direction. So now, momentum of the system, photon and electron, before collision is what? momentum of the photon before collision is h nu by c. In horizontal direction we are talking about. So momentum of the photon before collision is h nu by c. It's fully along the horizontal direction because the photon initially is moving horizontally. Okay, so its entire momentum is in the horizontal direction. Electron's momentum in the horizontal direction before collision is zero because the electron was at rest initially. After collision, what are the horizontal components of the momentum of photon? It is h nu dash by c cos theta, and of electron it is mv cos phi. So that's what we get it over here, h nu dash by c cos theta plus mv cos phi. Now rearranging this equation, you can work out this and see we'll be getting this formula. So I'm not going to explain to you how we work out this equation. Please work out and see on a separate page of your book. Okay, then similarly along vertical direction, momentum of the photon is how much in vertical direction before collision? The photon is moving entirely horizontally before collision, so that's why it doesn't have any vertical component. So it is zero. Electron also is zero, we know, because electron is at rest before collision. After collision, momentum of photon is vertical component is h nu dash by c sine theta, and it electron is downwards mv sine phi. So it becomes h nu dash by c sine theta minus, the minus sign here is indicating that the momentum of the electron after vertical component mv sine phi is downwards. Okay, so downward direction is negative, upward direction is positive. Again, rearranging this equation, we can show that it is this. Okay, so this is equation 4. Next, remaining part of the derivation is just some mathematical steps which you can follow easily. So what we do is now we take this equation 3 and 4, we square them up and add them. So we first square up this equation, then you square this equation and then add both the equations, you will get this. Now when you add up, you'll see over here in this equations m square v square c square, m square v square c square is common. So cos square phi plus sin square phi will become 1. Similarly on this side, cos square theta plus sin square theta is 1 because h square nu square, h square nu dash square, h square nu dash square is common. So you can work this out and see how we get this. So we get, after simplification, this equation becomes m square v square c square is equal to this. So this is equation number 5. So how we got this equation? We have squared equation 3, squared equation 4, and then we have added both the equations and then simplified, and we got this equation. Next, what we do is we take equation number 2, again we square both sides. Now be careful while you're squaring. So this is going to be slightly lengthy because there are two terms over here. So it will be, this left hand side squaring is simple, but right hand side squaring will be, this will be your A term, this will be your B term. So it will be A plus B the whole square. So you have to square carefully and see, you will get this equation. Okay, then so equation 6. Finally, what we do is we subtract equation 5 from 6. Okay, so 6 minus 5 we do, many terms will cancel out, you can work it out and see, and you will get this thing. After simplification, what is the last step we do is we substitute the value of m. Okay, what is m? M is here. Okay, so m is m0 upon the root of 1 minus v square by c square. So we substitute the value of m over here in this place, and on simplification, many things will, this c square minus v square, this common factor will cancel out, and we will get this equation. Okay, this is a very simple equation we get finally. Now next, what we do is we after getting this equation, we divide throughout by nu nu dash. So we get 1 upon nu dash is minus 1 upon nu is equal to h upon m0 c square into 1 minus cos theta. And finally, one of the c from here, we'll take it on this side. So we get it as c upon nu dash minus c upon nu is equal to h upon m0 c 1 minus cos theta. Okay. And what is c upon nu dash? C upon nu dash is nothing but lambda dash, and c upon nu is lambda. So we have lambda dash minus lambda is equal to h upon m0 c 1 minus cos theta. So what is lambda dash minus lambda? It is nothing but the Compton shift. So we have derived an expression for Compton shift. Lambda dash minus lambda is equal to h upon m0c 1 minus cos theta. So I have not gone in details of these steps over here. So I expect you to work out these steps. Everything is written in these notes here. So please follow the notes and see what is written, the squaring, the subtraction and all these things. It is going to be slightly lengthy, but you work it out separately, step by step, and you should be able to get it. So this is the final expression for Compton shift. We are going to slightly study different cases by putting different values of theta in this Compton shift expression, but that we'll do in the next class. Thank you.